Okay, so welcome everyone who is with us on Zoom. Thank you very much for tuning in. This, of course, is the College of Agriculture and Bioresources seminar series. This time around, we are focusing on food, bioproducts, and biotechnology, which is a pretty broad area here in our college, but there's a lot of really interesting research that is encapsulated in that theme. This seminar today is the sixth and final presentation in this theme that we are presenting. And the next one will be in January, topic to be determined. So thank you very much. Today we have Dr. Peter Slade with us today. Dr. Slade is an assistant professor in the Department of Agricultural and Resource Economics. He is also the Canadian Canola Growers Association Chair in Agricultural Policy. So Peter today is going to talk to us a bit about his research program, the work that he conducts under this chair, and some collaborations and partnerships that he engages in, as well as some implications for Saskatchewan agriculture, specifically related to policy. So thank you so much, Dr. Slade, for joining us today. And throughout the talk, if you have any questions, maybe just pop them in the chat. And then at the end of Peter's presentation, we will go through any questions that are posted there. So without further ado, Peter, I invite you to take it away.
Great. Thanks so much, Danielle. So really happy that you could all join us this afternoon. I'm going to chat about mostly about business risk management programs. I'll give kind of a overview of the programs just so that we're all brought up to speed, though probably most people on the call are as familiar with the programs as I am. And then I'll chat a little bit about what I see as some of the current issues in BRM programming, and kind of most importantly, some of the research that I'm doing with others in my department to kind of get a handle on the effects that BRM programs have on producer decision making, and hopefully that informs some of the current issues that policymakers are grappling with in BRM programming. So yeah, this overview, I guess, just captures what I said before. Hope to, at the end, have questions and time for a discussion. Don't be afraid to ask any hard questions, because it's take your child to work day. So I have my 14-year-old daughter here, who I'll pass off the presentation to if there are any difficult questions. So we're covered on that. Right, so to give a kind of quick overview of BRM programmings. It's kind of the primary policy that's supporting farm incomes in Canada. So in terms of kind of studying the economics of farm policy and how that interacts with farm decision-making, BRM programming is kind of the only game in town these days. They're jointly administered, or the federal and provincial governments are jointly responsible, I should have written, for BRM programming. And BRM programs are administered on the basis of five-year agreements between the federal and provincial governments, the latest of which is the Sustainable Canadian Agricultural Partnership that runs from the current year through 2028. And so kind of the four most prominent BRM programs within these five-year agreements are crop insurance, agri-insurance, agri-stability, Agri-Invest, which is a program that matches producers' contributions in a savings account, and Agri-Recovery, which is an ad hoc disaster assistance support program. So kind of most of the interest, I think, in policymaking and in economic research around business risk management programmings have been the first two programs, crop insurance and agri-stability. So I'll give a kind of, again, quick overview of these two programs to bring everyone up to speed if anyone isn't familiar with these two programs. So crop insurance is crop-specific insurance that covers producers when their yields are below between 50 and 80% of their long-run average, and producers are able to choose their level of coverage, whether they want to be covered at 50, 60, 70, or 80% of their long-term yields. And obviously, the premium reflects the amount of coverage that producers have chosen, with a higher level of coverage leading to a higher premium. But producers don't pay the full cost of insurance. In fact, producers only pay 40% of the actuarially fair cost of insurance. So I guess another way of saying that is there's a 60% subsidy on insurance, or as I tell my undergraduate students who are going back to the farm, for every dollar you put into crop insurance, you can expect to pull $2.50 out of the program. So it's generally a good deal for farmers, not just from a risk mitigation standpoint, but from an income support standpoint. And we'll talk a little bit more about that throughout the presentation. There's generally pretty high uptake in crop insurance in Saskatchewan, but only half of producers, or around half of producers, take full coverage. That's increased a bit over the past 5 years, but still only about half of producers take that 80% level of coverage. The other half take kind of 70% or below, which is somewhat surprising, I guess, given the level of subsidies that are offered on top of the actuarially fair price of insurance. AgriStability is a whole farm margin insurance program, so it covers producers when their margins fall below 70% of their reference margin, and the reference margin is based on a 5-year Olympic average of their past margins. Costs to enroll in the program are fairly low, so if on average when producers put a dollar into crop insurance, they get $2.50 out in the long run on average, that number is even higher for AgriStability. Crop insurance corporations are paying out, on average, I think over the past 5 years, it's been like somewhere between 5 and 10 times what they've been getting in terms of AgriStability payments versus the cost that producers are paying. Two recent issues with AgriStability have been changes in coverage over the past 20 years that have made the program less generous. And perhaps as a consequence of these changes in program design, we've seen lower enrollment in recent years. So just to kind of highlight the changes in program design to AgriStability, the predecessor to AgriStability was the Canadian Agricultural Income Stabilization Program, which ran from 2003 to 2008. And in this program, when producers' margins fell below 100%, of their reference margin, again, that reference margin is an average of the past 5 years of net margins. When it fell below 100%, you'd receive a payment, and that payment would be equal to 50% of the difference between your actual margin and that 100% threshold. If your margin fell further below 85% of the reference margin, you get a payment that's equal to the difference the difference between your actual margin and that reference margin, you get 70% of that back as a payment. And then if your margin was below 70% of the reference margin, you'd get a payment that was equal to 80 cents on the dollar for every dollar below that 70% threshold that your margin was. When AgriStability was introduced in 2008, in the next 5-year agreement, that top tier of coverage was dropped and was replaced by AgriInvest. And the rest of those tiers in the program remain the same. And then between 2013 and 2023, that next tier of coverage was also dropped so that you would only receive a payment if your margin fell below 70% of the reference margin. And in the most recent 5-year agreement, there was a small change to AgriStability in that that amount that you were paid when your margin fell below 70% of the reference margin was increased from 70% to 80%. So I'll talk maybe a little bit more about AgriStability more at the end of the presentation, and talk a little bit about why I think enrollment has fallen, or at least one explanation for why enrollment has fallen in this program over the past 15 or so years. Okay, so some of the key questions that our research, and when I say our, I mean myself and other people in the department, that our research has tackled about BRM programs are, do they actually succeed in mitigating producer risk? Do they distort producers' decision-making. Do producers make different decisions about the types of crops they're going to grow, the types of inputs that they're going to use when they're enrolled in BRM programs? How do BRM programs impact the environment, which I guess will be pretty critical now under the Sustainable Canadian Agricultural Partnership? And also looking at enrollment in certain programs, particularly agri-stability, and trying to diagnose some of the reasons for low enrollment. So the first kind of question that I want to talk about a bit is the role of BRM programs in mitigating risk. And it's pretty obvious that business risk management programs do mitigate risk. They give you a payment when your margin falls below 70% of your reference margin, or when you experience declines in your yield. However, what's kind of interesting about agricultural production insurance in general is that a wide swath of literature finds that producers are generally not willing to pay the full price for production insurance, and that we need subsidies in order to generate participation in these programs. So in Canada, we have a 60% subsidy for crop insurance, probably an even higher implicit subsidy for agri-stability. And we need these subsidies, perhaps not as high as they are, but we do need subsidies in order to induce producers to participate. And so that suggests that the risk mitigation that BRM programs provide are not fully valued by producers. So producers aren't willing to pay the full cost of the program. This kind of suggests that they don't value the risk mitigating aspect of a BRM program at its full price. And maybe one of the reasons for this is that producers have other ways of managing their risk, whether it's saving in good years so that they have money to draw on in bad years, whether it's hedging their price risk, whether it's crop diversification. Maybe these other tools mean that producers simply aren't willing to pay full price for insurance. And so one of the things that a lot of economic research about BRM programming in Canada highlights is that participating in BRM programs has kind of two effects on producers' profits or on their utility. One is that it reduces their risk profile, and the other is that it increases their income. As I said, for every dollar that you put into crop insurance, you can expect to get $2.50 out. And most research finds that the income effect of BRM programs is what's most important to producers. So there's a bit of a disconnect, I think, between how policymakers think about BRM programs. They really think about it as a risk mitigation tool, and the way that producers think about the program, which I think is largely as kind of an income subsidy. And so I think sometimes when we talk about BRM programs, there's a bit of a disconnect, as I said, between policymakers and producers who kind of value these aspects of the program differently. Okay, so the next thing to kind of chat about are BRM programs and producer decision-making. So there's a wide literature examining the effects of BRM programs on input use, acreage decisions. And some of the current research that that I'm looking at, along with others in the department, are the impacts of BRM programs on crop rotations and environmental outcomes. And kind of want to chat about those two things a little bit more. Kind of still in the first stages of some of this research, so happy to get kind of any feedback and suggestions on future directions. So first thing I want to chat about was BRM programs and their impacts on crop rotations. So we know that crop rotations in Saskatchewan are important to mitigating disease and maintaining yields. However, in recent years, rotations have become less diverse, particularly in the black and the dark brown soil zone, with producers growing canola more frequently. And so our research question here is, does insurance incentivize these tighter crop rotations, or does it incentivize producers to use more diverse crop rotations? And kind of a particularly important question, because there's an externality here. When producers use tighter canola rotations, that increases crop disease, which can spread to other fields. So if insurance is incentivizing these tighter crop rotations, it's not only harming the yields of the producer in question, but it could also be a vector for transmitting disease to other fields as well. So as I said, kind of in the first stages of this research, but just kind of want to present some of this initial work that I think leads to the hypothesis that insurance is in fact incentivizing these tighter rotations. So first, just want to present some evidence that rotations are in fact getting tighter. So this graph plots the for every field on which canola was planted in a given year, how many years there was between that planting of canola and the previous planting of canola. So for example, in the black soil zone in 2001, for all the fields that were planted with canola, about 45% of them did not have canola planted in the past 2 years. So the break between canola plantings were 3 years or more. And only about 20% of those fields had canola planted 2 years ago. So there's a 1 year break between canola plantings. And we see over the past 20 years that these rotations have become a lot tighter, that the number of fields on which canola have been planted with only a 1 year break has increased from 20% to now about 70%, right? And almost 10% of these fields have no break. So canola is being planted on top of canola. We see a similar thing in the dark brown soil zone with the number of fields on which, or the proportion of fields on which canola is grown that have had only a 1 year or 2 year break between canola plantings has increased to kind of almost 70%. And the number that have had a 3 year break or more is now a little under 30%. Less of an issue in the brown soil zone, which isn't as suited to canola. So the first kind of question that we wanted to look at when we think about tighter rotations is what impact do these rotations have on yield? And so these are some regression results that look at using field level data from the past 20 years. When you grow canola on a field that previously had canola, what is the yield loss? So if you grew canola 1 year ago, instead of having grown a cereal crop, your yields of canola on that field would be 7% lower. Conversely, if you had grown a pulse crop on that field as opposed to cereals, your yields would be 3.8 or 4.6% higher, depending on whether it was lentils or peas. If you had a 1 year break between canola planting, so if you planted canola 2 years ago, instead of having planted a grain crop 2 years ago, then your yields would be 2% lower versus if you had grown a pulse crop, your yields would be about 1.5% higher. And then those numbers kind of trail out as you look kind of further in the past. So if you had grown, If you had grown canola 3 years ago, as opposed to a grain or a cereal crop 3 years ago, your yields of canola would be about 1% lower. So to kind of think about the interaction between crop rotations and insurance, we can plot the yield distribution for canola. So this is the distribution of canola yields over the past 10 years, or I should say between 2011 and 2021. And if we think about a producer who has crop insurance coverage at 80%, we can kind of, from the perspective of the producer, truncate this yield distribution at this 80% threshold. So if your yields are below 80%, you're going to receive an insurance payment that's going to bring your yields up to that 80% threshold. So on the next graph, what I'm plotting is in the, with the red line, is the distribution of canola yields if you had grown canola on canola, whereas the black line plots your yields if you had grown canola on grains instead. And what we can see is that the probability of low yields when you grow canola on canola increases substantially. But as a producer, you're not really internalizing the cost of these lower yields, because as long as your yields are below 80%, insurance is going to bring you up to that 80% threshold. So you can still experience the benefits of growing canola in terms of achieving a higher price for canola than you're going to get for wheat or other cereal crops, at least in the past number of years. And you're kind of saved from the downside when you're insured at an 80% level, or even if you're insured at a lower level. So kind of the punchline here is that the loss in revenue from tight rotations is less when you're insured. There are some dynamic considerations here. If you have lower yields, then your coverage will be less in future years. But at least if you're kind of thinking about your profitability in this particular year, using a tight rotation is going to be more preferred when you're insured than when you're uninsured. And this leads us to the hypothesis that crop insurance reduces the incentive for diversified rotations. We're kind of digging into this question a little bit more using some econometric models to look at crop choice and also some programming models that look at producers' optimal decision-making around their crop rotation. So work that's very much in progress and would be happy for any feedback or comments on the future direction of this research. Another thing to chat about are the interaction between BRM programs and environmental outcomes. And this work is coming out in the Canadian Journal of Agricultural Economics. It's joint with Tristan, who is in my department, and also some colleagues at Guelph. And in the paper, we kind of dig into the effects that BRM programs have on environmental outcomes, and we highlight effects that are on the intensive margin and the extensive margin. So intensive margin effects is what economists would call the effects that are happening on a field that you're going to plant with, that you're going to plant regardless of whether there are BRM programs or not. And the extensive margin effects would capture the effects of bringing additional land into production because of BRM programs. So on the intensive margin, on fields that you're going to plant regardless of whether you're in a BRM program or not, most of the literature has highlighted that your input use is going to be reduced when you take insurance. So fertilizer and chemicals are chemicals like herbicide, pesticide, are generally reduced when you take insurance. The reason for this is, you know, if you experience a crop loss because of low chemical use, then that's going to be covered by insurance. So you have less of an incentive to apply inputs when you're insured versus when you're not. And so from the perspective of environmental outcomes, this is seen as beneficial because you're going to reduce fertilizer and chemical runoff on your fields. We also find that agricultural insurance generally engenders a shift towards riskier crops. So as we talked about in the past topic, we hypothesize that crop rotations are going to shift producers to, that crop insurance is going to shift producers to use riskier crop rotations. We also kind of think that it's going to shift you towards growing more canola or growing canola more intensively. And since canola is a more input intensive crop, that may actually counteract the effect that insurance has on input use. So you might be using less inputs on every field that you're growing canola on, but if you're growing canola on more fields, it's a little bit unclear what the total effect on fertilizer use would be. On the extensive margin, we generally find that agricultural insurance increases production, particularly production on marginal land, and it can encourage the conversion of pasture land into cropland. And the impacts that this has on GHG emissions is something that we discuss as being unclear at this point. So if you're converting pasture land to croplands, you might be creating more emissions from land use changes. But if you're growing less cattle, we know that cattle are perhaps the largest source of agricultural emissions. You'd be reducing emissions from enteric fermentation and manure management. So it's a little bit unclear how conversion of pasture land nets out in terms of GHG emissions. So that's a topic for future research. So the policy recommendations that we make at the end of this article are one, conditioning insurance rates on crop rotations and best management practices. So if you're adopting a more diverse crop rotation, that should make your yields less variable. And if crop insurance took that into consideration, then your actuarially fair rate should be lower when you adopt more diverse rotations. Ditto if you adopt other best management practices that have environmental benefits and also make your production more sustainable and less variable. We also suggest that provincial crop insurers could look into insurance for best management practices. Some provincial insurers have already done this, such as Prince Edward Island, looking at providing insurance for producers who try such management practices as intercropping. And finally, we suggest that BRM programs could have some form of cross-compliance, where in order to enroll in a BRM program, producers would have to perhaps complete an environmental farm plan or a nutrient management plan. Such cross-compliance is already in place in Quebec for their agri-stability program. And, you know, environmental farm plans, nutrient management plans, it's a bit debatable what effect that they have, but they're generally a low-cost way of getting producers to think about the impacts that their operation have on the environment, and kind of getting producers thinking about it could potentially have some benefits. So that's something I think that we need to study a little bit more, but I think it's an interesting direction for government and crop insurers to look into if they want to kind of incentivize greater environmental outcomes through BRM programming. Okay, so the final kind of topic that I wanted to chat about was agri-stability enrollment and some research that we've done examining incentives to enroll in agri-stability and perhaps explaining some of the reduced enrollment in agri-stability over the past 15 or 20 years. So the graph on this slide shows agri-stability enrollment among Canadian producers, and this is across all provinces, across all types of producers, so including both livestock and crop producers. We see that enrollment in agri-stability is at about 30% of producers, and it covers about 54% of farm market revenue in Canada. So the obvious implication is that larger farms are more likely to enroll in the program than smaller farms. And this figure, particularly the 54% figure, is consistent with what we see among Saskatchewan crop producers. So between 2017 and 2020, about 51 to 53% of revenue is covered by agri-stability coming from SCIC's annual reports. So some of the reasons for this relatively low enrollment that have been proffered by policymakers and academics are kind of first and foremost the changes to program design that have happened in the past 20 years that I covered at the beginning of the talk. Obviously, agri-stability has become less generous over the past 20 years, and so that disincentivizes producer enrollment in the program. The program is also seen as complex. It has involved producers having to use accrual accounting to account for their inputs and outputs. The timeliness of the program has been an issue, with producers having to submit their tax forms, and then agri-stability is based on these filings, and so you're not going to get a payment until many months after you've actually experienced an income decline. And because of the complexity of the program, it's difficult for producers to predict when they're going to receive an agri-stability payment. AAFC has also noted that there might be a lack of information about agri-stability among producers. And kind of one of the reasons that I want to dig into a little bit more is the impact of market conditions on agri-stability enrollment. So kind of the argument that I make in this paper, which was published a couple of years ago, is that from the perspective of crop producers, if you're able to hedge your price risk through futures or forward contracts, and if you've already purchased the lion's share of your inputs before you need to enroll in agri-stability, and you're covered by crop insurance against declines in production, what risk really remains for agri-stability to cover? So if output prices are high and you've locked in those output prices, you've already purchased your inputs, you know crop insurance is going to cover you if you have a decline in production, then it's really hard to get your margin below the 70% of the reference margin that's needed to trigger a payment. So at the outset of the crop year, you might already know with a substantial probability that you can't receive an agri-stability payment because of how you've already hedged your risks. So to kind of explore this, I use a farm simulation model to analyze the incentives to enroll in agri-stability and to hedge your price risk, which can be done through either futures contracts or forward contracts. So I build a representative farm in three Saskatchewan RMs, rural municipalities, and run the model over 10,000 simulated years with prices kind of following a mean reverting process. And so in this simulation, I'm going to find producers' optimal behavior, their behavior in terms of how much they want to hedge and whether they want to enroll in agri-stability or not, or whether it's optimal to enroll in agri-stability or not across four different scenarios. One, you can hedge, but you aren't able to enroll in agri-stability. Second, you can't hedge and you can't enroll in agri-stability, which is kind of the base scenario. Third, you're able to do both. And fourth, you're not able to hedge, but you're able to enroll in agri-stability. And so the results show how price hedging is going to impact your optimal enrollment in agri-stability. And it will also show how the availability of hedging is going to impact agri-stability. Sorry, let me flip that around for part B. How agri-stability is going to impact your incentive to hedge, or what your hedge ratio is. So here's the simulation results. So kind of in the results that I'm showing now, this is when producers are allowed to enroll in agri-stability, but they are not able to hedge their price risk through futures contracts or forward contracts. So you know what the spring price is, let's say at the beginning of the year, but you don't know what the price is going to be when you go to sell your output after harvest. So if this was the case, if you're not able to hedge, then it's almost always optimal for producers to enroll in agri-stability. So across the three RMs, the RM that's close to Yorkton, close to Saskatoon, close to Swift Current, you should enroll in agri-stability almost or over 90% of the time, getting up to almost 100% of the time in Swift Current. But this changes a lot when you're able to hedge your output price risk. So when you're able to hedge your output price risk, it's only optimal to enroll in agri-stability about between 50 and 60% of the time in Yorkton and Swift Current, and about 80% of the time in Saskatoon. So again, what's happening in these years when you don't want to enroll in agri-stability, what's happening is your output prices are relatively high compared to what your reference margin is. So when you are able to lock in those high output prices, there's just very little probability, or in some cases, it's a 0% chance that you're actually able to receive an agri-stability payment because your reference margin just can't, or sorry, your net margin can't fall below 70% of your reference margin because you're already locked into relatively high prices and you're protected against yield loss by agri insurance. Likewise, we can look at what the optimal hedge ratio is, both with and without agri-stability. So when you have agri-stability, your optimal hedge ratio across the three regions is kind of somewhere between 0.35 and 0.4. So this hedge ratio is the proportion of your expected output that you want to hedge. So somewhere between 0.35, somewhere between 35% and 40%. Of your expected output you would want to hedge through a futures contract or forward contracting. Without agri-stability, that hedge ratio is higher in the three different RMs, somewhere between 0.43 and 0.67. So the kind of takeaway here is agri-stability reduces the incentive to use other risk management tools, particularly hedging in this case. So kind of the takeaways from this simulation is to me that agri-stability kind of acts less as insurance against in-season risk. So your in-season risk being how yields might decline or how prices might decline within a season, So I think agri-stability should be seen less as an insurance policy against in-season risk and more as protection against year-over-year price changes. So if output prices have fallen a lot, and who knows when we'll enter a regime of lower output prices, but I'm sure it will come at some point. When we're in that regime of lower output prices, I think we're going to see agri-stability becoming a more valuable program to consumers, or to consumers, to producers, not because it's protecting them against in-season risk, but because they know once they hedge their prices and the prices that they hedge at are a lot lower, that there's a really high probability that they'll receive an agri-stability payment because prices have declined year over year, not because of within-year price risk. So low enrollment in agri-stability, I think, is expected when output prices are high, and higher enrollment should be expected when output prices are low. Another kind of takeaway is that agri-stability reduces the incentive for producers to hedge their risk through futures or forward contracts. So kind of some conclusions to sum up the entire presentation. BRM programs can impact producer decision-making. It can change the types of crops you want to grow, the rotations that you're going to use, the inputs that that you're going to apply. But I think the size of these effects is not well understood. We know that there are some moral hazard issues, which is that producers act differently when they're insured versus when they're not. But how large these effects are, I think, are not well understood, particularly in the Canadian context. Another takeaway is that BRM programs interact with other risk management tools. So when you're insured, you're less likely to hedge your risk through futures or forward contracts. You might also be less likely to, you know, engage in intertemporal income smoothing, crop diversification, kind of other risk management tools are going to be affected by your enrollment in agricultural insurance. Third kind of conclusion, or maybe kind of something to add, is that I think the effects of BRM programs on producer decision-making in Canada is very much an under-researched area. So we have some hints about the types of effects that agricultural insurance would have from other areas, but there's very little kind of primary research looking at these issues in the Canadian context. So that's kind of a gap in the literature that myself and others in the department are hoping to fill, and would love any comments or suggestions from the audience about kind of particular questions that you would like to see addressed. And with that, I guess I'll conclude, and really happy to take any questions, comments, or any suggestions for future research. And I think I see something in the chat right now. Take a look. So Tom says a comment, the impact of tight rotations on yield per se may not be the key question, as disease resistance may take multiple years and have a big effect potentially on the entire industry in case of breeding solutions not readily at hand. So yeah, I certainly agree with that comment, Tom. And I think, the notion that crop insurance can incentivize people to use kind of tighter rotations could be a particularly key impact that insurance could have if it's going to have these externalities, that it breaks down disease resistance over time, which again would affect an entire region. But happy to take any other questions, comments.
Great. Thank you, Peter, very much for that. So if anyone has questions, you can either pop them in the chat or you can just unmute yourself if you prefer that. Maybe I'll get things started. This might be a bit outside the presentation content, and if it is, I apologize. But Peter, are you able to comment at all on how climate change is affecting the way that crop insurance works, or affecting the way that producers view crop insurance in terms of having to deal with drought or changing length of seasons, etc.?
I think both policymakers in crop insurance and farmers are kind of increasingly worried about changing climate, and I think agricultural insurance is kind of the primary tool that governments can offer to producers to try to mitigate the impact of a changing climate. So yeah, I'm not sure that I have kind of any brilliant insights other than to suggest that probably crop insurance is going to become a more important tool for producers and a more important policy going forward if we do see kind of more variation in climate going forward.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. And I mean, coming from someone who doesn't really understand a lot about the nuances of how crop insurance works, like if there's a particular year where there are a lot of claims put in for crop insurance, you know, if there's a really severe drought or, you know, a lot of storms or something where crops are damaged, I mean, presumably there's only a set pot of money available. Mm-hmm. I mean, is there ever any concern that the amount of payout to producers is going to have to start decreasing just because there are so many claims being put in, or is that not a thing based on the model?
It's not premiums for agricultural insurance, for crop insurance, are intended to be actuarially fair. Right now, Saskatchewan crop insurance has a pretty big nest egg, and actually there's been some economists who have argued that rates have been set too high, Saskatchewan crop insurance reserves have been built up too much. And so I think that those arguments have become less forceful after the past couple of years. Provincial crop insurers also have the option to reinsure, so they can take their risk and insure that with a larger insurer. So if there is ever the risk that that there isn't enough in the reserves to make a payment, crop insurance can always reinsure. Obviously, there's some cost to that. So I don't think there's an issue with crop insurance running out of money. The bigger issue would be if we see yields becoming more variable, obviously premiums are going to have to increase, and are producers going to be willing to pay those higher premiums?
Great, thank you. Tom has had his hand up for a couple minutes. Tom?
Yeah, thanks a lot, Peter. Maybe just to follow on my comment about crop rotations, I wonder, is there any talk in the crop insurance companies about, you know, insuring a good rotation as opposed to insuring every rotation?
Yeah, I think I don't know if anyone's in the audience from SCIC, that they could probably speak to this better than I could, but from my discussions with SCIC, I think it's something that they are worried about, something that they're kind of interested in. I don't think that they've taken any action now to kind of differentially price insurance based on your rotation. I know people who use kind of a tighter rotation and grow continuous canola for many years could be denied coverage. I'm not sure that they actually have denied coverage to those people. I think they generally send a threatening letter saying that they may if their rotation practice isn't changed. So I'm not aware of them seriously considering any policy, but I think it's something that's certainly in their minds. And so the research that we're doing is relying on crop insurance data, and it's something that crop insurance is supportive of. And I think it's something that they want to kind of learn more about and potentially develop policies to address if rotations kind of continue to be tight.
Thank you.
We have a question in the chat here, Peter. Do you think that adding environmental cross compliance to future programs will have large impacts on enrollment in terms of producers viewing the programs as complex?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think it depends on what the cross compliance is, right? So enrollment in agri-stability in Quebec is quite high because the program is made more generous by the provincial government in Quebec, and they have pretty high enrollment despite requiring an environmental farm plan. Of course, you can, you know, come up with some farm plan. I don't think that they get a grade. I don't know that anyone's farm plan is rejected, right? So that's, I guess, a pretty low bar for cross-compliance. So I think of it something like developing a plan, which is just kind of trying to nudge producers towards better behavior. I would be skeptical that would reduce enrollment that much. Again, if your cross-compliance measures, you know, require producers to adopt other management practices that might be more costly, then absolutely there could be issues about compromising in enrollment in that case.
Thank you. Another question in the chat. How much influence do farmers or other people working in the industry have on the policymaking for crop insurance?
That's a good question, and maybe a little bit above my pay grade. I think whenever there is a new five-year agreement, there is a wide consultation by AAFC and by provincial ministries, trying to engage with producers and producer groups. And kind of my sense of it is that producer groups are pretty good at advocacy, and are very involved in those talks. Ultimately, you know, how much power they have, I guess, is maybe a question that political scientists would have to use their tools to get at. But certainly they are a big part of those consultation processes that happen every 5 years.
Thank you. Any other questions, either over the microphone or in the chat? I guess I have another question, Peter. So I was really interested in the simulations that you presented on the acre stability with hedging versus not hedging. Are there online tools or online calculators that producers can use to help out with these types of decisions? Or is everyone just kind of making the decisions based on their experience and their knowledge and, you know, market trends and that type of thing?
Yeah, I'm not aware of any online tools. I think most farm consultants, farm accountants kind of have their own kind of spreadsheet in which they input things from producers, and it spits out something about kind of optimal hedge ratios and what pretty producers should be growing. Just to kind of highlight some of the research that we're doing, we are trying to kind of build some of those tools for farmers, hoping that those types of things will come out in the next year or two. But I'm not super aware of any kind of tool that you could kind of put in your farm information and it would spit out a hedge ratio or anything like that, though. I don't know, maybe someone else on the call has more ideas than I do about the tools that are out there.
And do you think that crop insurance providers would be okay with those types of tools? I mean, it's kind of like, I don't know, would it be considered kind of like the counting cards of like crop insurance? Like, because I mean, they make a lot of their money by people paying premiums who don't actually end up cashing in, right? Like that's how insurance companies make their money. So how do you think would insurance providers view tools like that would be predictive based on stats or trends or anything like that?
I guess the broader comment is that insurance in Canada is delivered through government. So I think that their goal is not necessarily maximizing profit, because they're delivering premiums that are actuarially fair. So they're not really making any profit. Their goals are more to kind of support producer decision-making. I guess the other point to make is that to the extent that these tools exist, I think that they would always be encouraging farmers to take more insurance. So as I said in the presentation, only 50% of farmers are taking full insurance right now. And it's always optimal as long as premiums are in fact actuarially fair and subsidized by 60%. It's always optimal for producers to take more insurance. So I think the more information that are provided to producers, the more tools that are available to producers to understand their risk profile and the benefits of different risk management tools, the more of that information that's provided, the more likely it is that producers are going to take more crop in insurance. So my guess is that the Crop Insurance Corporation would be in favor of any tool that gave producers more information, because better informed producers are probably more likely to enroll in crop insurance.
Thank you. Any other questions or comments for Peter? Okay. Well, thank you very much, Peter. This seminar will be available to view on the website as well as the slides. So thank you. And I assume that Peter would welcome anybody contacting him for follow-up or with questions or anything like that, or comments about his research program. So thank you very much, Peter, for taking the time to talk to us. We really appreciate it. And thank you to everyone who joined us.
Awesome. Thank you.
All right. Take care, everyone.